As of May of 2020, over 1 million people worldwide have contracted the coronavirus, and those numbers are increasing with each passing day. Efforts to find effective treatments and develop vaccines are underway, but still, the best strategy against the coronavirus is to avoid getting it at all. However, implementing that strategy has resulted in the closing down of businesses, schools, and universities. Most international borders have been sealed off. The social and economic toll has impacted everyone on the planet. While many repurposed pharmaceutical drugs are currently in clinical trials, drug treatments are not preventative. They're only administered to sick patients. And since the severity of symptoms varies from person to person, it's unlikely that a repurposed drug will end up being a one-glove-fit-all solution. So in parallel to the search for drug treatments, researchers are desperately trying to develop a vaccine. However, unlike repurposed drugs, where you can skip having to do basic research, you can't take shortcuts with developing a new vaccine. Some individuals who have recovered from the coronavirus are donating blood plasma because that plasma contains antibodies that their immune systems use to overcome the infection. Those antibodies can be used to treat patients, but it's obviously not practical as a universal treatment. The goal of a vaccine would be to give everyone the innate tools to fight off the virus without having to contract the real thing. A vaccine simulates an infection and primes the body's immune system. It gives the immune system an opportunity to develop the know-how in dealing with a particular pathogen and makes it ready for when the real pathogen attacks. Vaccines build up the immune system's arsenal by priming the development of two types of weapons. One, antibodies, and two, killer T cells. Antibodies directly target the pathogen by attaching to the pathogen's exterior and preventing it from infecting cells. When the antibodies attach to the pathogen, it's like the pathogen gets stuck in quicksand. It's game over. After the pathogen gets swarmed, it's time for the immune system to clean up the garbage. The parts of the antibodies that are not bound to the pathogen signal for macrophage cells that come up and gobble up the antibody-ensnared pathogen. So that's strategy one in a nutshell. Disable the pathogen with antibodies and get rid of the mess. Strategy two focuses on targeting cells that have already been infected. When that happens, it's killer T cell time. Killer T cells are basically the John Wicks of our immune system. When a cell's been infected, you call in the hit squad. Killer T cells are programmed to find infected cells and take them out before the pathogen gets a chance to replicate and spread. Think about how you would stop a zombie apocalypse. You can set up traps for the zombies and kill them after they get caught. That would be the antibody approach. Or you can target victims who've already been infected and euthanize them before they become a zombie. That's the killer T cell approach. Now, depending on the nature of the disease, the immune system might favor one method of attack over the other, but usually a combination of the two gets the job done. But how does the body know which antibodies to produce and which killer T cells to deploy? Answer: antigens. Antigens are biomarkers that are unique to a pathogen, kind of like fingerprints. Whether it's a bacteria, virus, or a parasite, they all have specific antigens present on their exteriors which are unique to them. Those antigens are not found on any human cell, and the immune system is constantly on the lookout for anything bearing those foreign fingerprints. And when it finds one that does not belong, it's go time. Now, both antibody-producing cells and killer T cells have to undergo a training regimen of sorts before they can be deployed as soldiers in the field. The immune system has to make sure that they know what side they're fighting on. Our bodies are in the business of staying alive. If antibody-producing cells make antibodies that attack the body's own cells, that's bad for business. Similarly, if killer T cells can't tell the difference between friend and foe, they're going to cause a lot more harm than good. Antibody-producing cells, called B cells, are screened in a selection process in the bone marrow. If they produce antibodies which don't target human cells, they're allowed to continue to develop. Otherwise, they're discontinued. Killer T cells undergo their maturation in the thymus gland and similarly undergo a test to see whether they'll activate when they encounter human cells. If that happens, they're not allowed to graduate killer T cell training school. And if you don't graduate killer T cell training school, you're getting tossed in the same dump pile as rejected Spartans. Hey, the body takes defending the homeland very seriously. Each individual B cell and killer T cell is specialized to recognize one and only one type of antigen, one very specific chemical fingerprint. There are millions of individualized B cells and killer T cells that are capable of recognizing any antigen that biology can produce. After graduation, B cells and killer T cells basically wait around in our lymphatic system until they're called in for action. And there they stay, waiting for the off chance that a pathogen bearing the antigen that they've been hardwired to recognize decides to invade. When a pathogen first begins to infect cells, the infected cells raise the alarm. At that point, they're not going to survive, but there's one thing that they can do. They can take the antigen from the invader and present it to the surface in order to notify the immune system that trouble is afoot. Immune messenger cells gather up the antigen, salute the fallen cell for its noble service, and get to work. These messenger cells migrate to the lymphatic system and brush by every B cell and T cell that they can find, searching for the ones that are a match for the antigen. And when the messenger cells find them, it's time to build an army. The other millions of B cells and killer T cells that have graduated training? They aren't part of the fight. They're built to recognize other antigens, and they can't be reprogrammed. Instead, the B cells and killer T cells that have the right programming, well, they begin to multiply like rabbits in mating season. Legions and legions of identical antibody-producing B cells and identical killer T cells begin to amass, gearing up for battle. The B cells become wartime antibody factories, continuously pumping out antibodies until the threat has abated. Killer T cells reproduce and go into John Wick mode. They hunt down and destroy infected cells until there are none left to find. When the war is over, the antibody factories and killer T cells wind down their activity. Their numbers shrink, their services are no longer required. At least for now. There's always a chance that the invaders might return, and the immune system will need to call them up for duty again. So just enough of those battle-hardened B cells and killer T cells are kept around in active reserve. They become memory cells, ready to deploy at a moment's notice should the need arise. And if that happens, the immune response will be so swift and the pathogen's defeat so crushing that the second invasion won't even have a chance to establish a single foothold. The goal of a vaccine is to get the immune system ready for that second invasion by simulating the first. Crafting the right vaccine is a delicate balancing act of creating enough of a simulated infection in order to build up enough B cells and killer T cells, but not overdoing it to the point of causing harm to the patient. Safety is of paramount importance in vaccine clinical trials, and the bar for receiving FDA approval is set very high. There are hundreds of drug treatments available to treat infectious diseases, but there are only a few dozen vaccines available in the United States. The case of the coronavirus is unprecedented. Researchers around the world are united and focused on finding a vaccine. And maybe, just maybe, a safe and effective vaccine can restore things back to normal. Time will tell. If you enjoyed the video, please give it a thumbs up and hit the subscribe button. And if you'd like to learn more about vaccine design, tune in to episode 5 of the Tree of Knowledge podcast. You can find the link in the description below. And as always, thanks for watching and stay curious.